All right, everybody, welcome. Tonight's class is about. Is about what? What is the
class? Life.
How to live.
How to live. What? We don't know how to live?
We forget.
No.
We forget?
We forget, yeah.
Get occupied with other things.
What do we get occupied with?
Our thoughts.
Can you control your thoughts?
Yeah.
Can you?
Can you truly try?
The extent of it, how long it lingers.
Right, right. We constantly bombard with all kind of thoughts, right? Every second, so many thoughts comes to our mind. But, you know, I want to mention something from the Torah. I know, even though you guys like it to be more intellectual, and it will be more intellectual, but I have to refer something so we can make sense of what God thinks about life. So if we can understand, if we can connect to the consciousness of God, of what does He mean by living and life, and then maybe we can have a clear picture of what is our perception is towards living. You know, when you study the life of all the patriarchs in Torah, Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov, Yosef, Moshe, you see that so many pages of the Torah is dedicated to the life of the patriarchs, and the life of the patriarchs are all full of challenges, all the time. Abraham had challenges, Isaac had challenges, and Jacob, Yaakov, Israel, which we all come from him, he had the most challenging life. From the moment he was in his womb, he had challenge with his twins, he was born with all the challenges, he went every minute of his life, for 130 years of his life, he didn't have one quiet time. He didn't take any vacation. He didn't go to Paris. He didn't go to Mexico. He didn't go to a movie theater. He didn't smoke a galleon, hookah. You know, he didn't have any break. He had challenging life, and there are five parashot, five sections of the Torah, 100 pages of the Torah is dedicated to the challenge of his life. And this week parsha, the name of this parsha was Vayichi, which means his life, he lived. He lived 17 years in Egypt. And apparently those were his vacation time, his great time, his peaceful time. And that's all the Torah talks about. Half a sentence. That Yaakov lived 17 years in Egypt. That's all. Somehow God gives so much attention, so much details of the challenges of Yaakov. And when it comes to his peaceful time, vacation time, and easy life, half a sentence. Another thing I want to share with you guys. If you guys go see a movie, let's say a love story. A couple want to get together, and they have all kind of challenges in their relationship, in their love. It's a 2 hours movie, and they go through all the challenges of getting together and be together. And it's a happy ending movie. At the end of the movie, the two lovers get married, and they walk into the sunset. What happens? The movie's over. It's over. I mean, once they go to peaceful time, once the challenge is over, the movie is over. The excitement is over. So what is Torah telling us? What are the people in Hollywood are telling us? If you go to a movie, and the movie is about this couple that they love each other and have a wonderful time and they don't argue, they love each other, kiss, kiss, nana, no challenge, no nothing, no argument, nothing. Will you stay or will you walk out? You will walk out.
It's too perfect.
It's too boring. Right? It's too boring. If there is no excitement, no challenges, nothing in the movie, you're probably, most probably going to walk out. So I guess what God is telling us, that we're having a wrong perception about living a life. Somehow God is telling us a life with no challenge is no life. A life with no challenge is no life. But why the challenges are so difficult? All right, give us a challenge, but you know, let me have my time. All right, I'll face the challenges a little bit here and there, but let me be. Don't bug me. Don't tease me. Why so many people in my life giving me challenge? Why my parents are giving me challenge? Why my family is giving me challenge? Why my friends are giving me challenge? Why school is giving me challenge? Why my work is giving me challenge? Why the government is giving me challenge? Why the environment is giving me challenge? Why can't I just let it be? Why God can give me a little bit of challenge? And why the challenges are so difficult? Why I cannot make sense of the challenges in my life? Why hard times last for so long? Why difficult times last for so long and the happy times are short? Why when I buy a new suit, the joy of it the first day and then the second day goes down and after a while I want another suit? The excitement is not there. I buy a new car. The joy of the new car is 1 day, 2 days, okay. 1 month from the purchasing of the car, I don't even care if my car is dirty. Why the first bite is good, the second bite is not as good as the first bite, and by the end of my food, I don't really care. What happens? We're learning Kabbalah classes that there is a light behind every challenge. Right? We just learned. We talked about it last week and the weeks before. There is a light behind every challenge. There is a light behind the darkness. All right, all this beautiful cliche. But why can't I see it right away? What blocks me to see it? And when a challenge comes to my life, who's facing this challenge? Is it just me? Is it my ego? Is it my selfishness? Is it the me? Has my soul has to do anything with this challenge? Am I listening to my soul? Is my soul talking to me? Is he or she is telling me something? Is she giving me hint? How can I connect to my soul? Well, guess what? Every night, your soul leaves your body at night when you sleep and goes up to God and says, God, I'm fed up with this body. This body is so much into himself or herself. Is constantly worried about himself or herself. It's constantly looking for peace of mind, time out, instant gratification, instant jiggity. And he's not standing up to the challenges of his life. And I'm fed up. What can we do? And the God says, all right, go back. I'll give him another challenge tomorrow. I'll give him another chance tomorrow. So your soul truly wants the challenge. Because most probably, the soul sees the light behind the challenge. But my body doesn't see it. My ego doesn't see it. You know, something happens and totally throws me off. I become very reactive and I can't make sense of it. It takes me a while to see it. I have to really work on it. It depresses me. It saddens me. It puts me behind. I'm not happy about it. Why? What happens? In a nutshell, it all depends how we look at the challenges in our life. It all depends how you look at your challenges. What is your perception of life? Is it all good or is it not good? Maybe part of it is good. Maybe not the whole thing is good. Which part of me is telling me the whole part, the whole thing is not good. Every time that I become reactive, every time that I rush, every time that I judge, every time that I don't exercise patience, every time that I stick to my comfort zone, every time that I'm into myself, every time the whole world is about me, every time that I don't come out of myself, every time that I don't work on myself to change myself, every time I feed an energy force. There are two energy forces in the world. There's only two. It's actually one energy force. In reality, there is only light. Nothing but light. There's only light that has its own force, has its own energy, and is all around. It's all around, just like the movie of Star Wars. Force is all around. So what about the dark side? What about the dark force? Doesn't that have an energy of its own? No. Even science proves that. The dark side, the dark energy, doesn't really exist unless I invest in it, unless I feed it, unless I give it food, unless I nourish it. How do we nourish it? By the illusion that it's here. By the illusion that it creates and I become reactive. Every time I become sad, every time I become upset, every time I'm reactive, I'm going to use this because there are only two ways, either being proactive or reactive. Every time that I'm reactive, every time I don't have patience, every time I can't make sense of it, every time that I'm not in control of my life, I am investing in the bank of darkness. I am feeding the dark lord. I am feeding the dark force. And what happens? It's like I have glasses on, and every time that I get upset, I get disappointed, I get sad, I become selfish, I become judgmental, I'm not happy with the situation, things are not going my way, it's not my way, I'm not getting what I want. Every time that I have that consciousness, I'm feeding this force, this negative force, and it becomes a klipa, a layer of a darkness, and it hovers around me and makes things even more difficult. It's like having a glass on, and every time that I fall into my reactive mode, my glass becomes darker and darker and darker. And even if I get up in the morning and I'm in a great mood and I see everything clear and I can make sense of everything, but if something happens that I'm react and I don't like it, it gradually makes my glass darker and darker. At the end of the day, at night, I'm all sad, depressed, and I can't make sense of everything because I have created a shell of darkness around me that is not letting me to see the good that is around me. It all depends how you perceive things. Your perception is your reality. You make your reality. Your perception makes your reality. If a challenge comes to you and you immediately say, well, just wait a second. Why this person is in my life? Why this thing is happening in my life? Why am I experiencing this challenge? Just pause it for a second. Just without reacting, just wait for a second. Just, okay, what is it here? Am I being reactive? The moment you pause, the moment you say, I don't want to be reactive towards this challenge. I just don't want to. You pause, you push back. You push back. The moment you push back, the light force comes in. The light comes in. It becomes clear. All of a sudden, you're not under the control of that challenge. You are in control of that challenge. The challenges take over you when you react to it. You know, I want to give you a silly example. Mr. Trump, he's so reactive, right? Something comes in, boom, tweet comes out. Boom, tweet comes out. Some people like it, some people don't. For him, it's not a good thing. Why? Because he's reacting to it. He probably won't say the same thing if he would wait a couple hours later. Right? If he would say, why would I answer to this guy? Why would I react to this guy? What is it there for me? Why should I give credit to this guy and that guy? So every time we react to a situation, we become a laborer, we become slave to that challenge. And you're not in control now. You're not in control now. And then you're feeding that force, and it becomes darkened, and it becomes more difficult for you to understand. So the idea is to know, to have the certainty, to have the certainty that every challenge that comes to my life, whatever shape, whatever form, through whichever channel that comes to my life, is good. It's good. First, why is it coming to me? Because I can handle it. Otherwise, it would not have come to you. God will never give you an ounce more than what you can handle. Never. Never. If you can graduate from the second glass, he would only test you the second glass test. He would not give you a fifth grade class test to you. No. Only what you can handle. But sometimes, I don't want to go through it. It's too harsh. It's too difficult. I don't feel like it. I'm not in a mood of it. I'm not ready for it. It's not what I want. It's not what I want. I want the easy way out. I want that 17 years of Yaakov who lived happily ever after, but there is nothing of it. There is nothing of it. Only the challenges that Yaakov went through is written in details. In details. Only when you overcome a challenge, you feel happy, you feel content with yourself. Every time you let go, every time you run away from it, every time you think it's not coming from the life force, it's a dark thing, it's not good for me, I don't feel like it, I don't want to deal with it. You run away from it, and it becomes stronger and stronger and stronger. Every time you run away from a challenge, every time you don't want to deal with the situation, it becomes tougher, tougher, and stronger for you to handle it. So your perception totally changes the reality of the challenges you face. Your perception, again, I'm going to repeat this so many times, hopefully it really sinks in your consciousness. Your perception makes your reality. If you think your life is amazing, your life is amazing. If you truly believe in yourself, whatever God throws at me, no matter how curved the ball is, I can handle it, you can handle it. You say, bring it on, bring it on. You guys don't remember, you know, we had this boxer, Muhammad Ali Clay. He was a great, great boxer. What was his most powerful tool? When he would go in rings, he would call the guy and says, come on, hit me. Come on, hit me harder. Why? You're encouraging your competitor to give you harder a box? Harder punch? What are you asking? But what did it do? It destroyed the competition power or confidence.
Confuse them.
Bravo. And then what he would say, you can't hurt me. There's nothing you can do. It's all about the perception. It's about how you look at it. It's about understanding, accepting, knowing that whatever your scenario is, whatever that movie is that God created in front of you, is the best thing for you, is the best thing for you, and you absolutely can handle it. Otherwise, it wouldn't be in your movie. It's for you. It's going to make you stronger. You're going to make you better. You're going to learn from it. You're going to grow from it. It's going to help you change yourself. We all need to go through these changes. Every one of us. Nobody's perfect. We all have issues. We all have uncertainties in our life. They're all flaws in our character, in our consciousness. We're born like that. We're born like that. We have a lot of talents. Every one of us have a special talents. very, very, very a special talent. What you have, or what she has, or what you have, nobody else has. What you can accomplish, nobody else can accomplish in this world. Nobody. Nobody. But the only way that you reach that potential is to believe in yourself, to know that you can handle it, to know that it's for you. And when you know it, you capture it, and you reach that potential. You know, it says in the Torah that Adam knew Eve got pregnant. What do you mean Adam knew Eve got pregnant? There was no intercourse? Of course there was intercourse. So why God is telling us Adam knew Eve became pregnant? Knowing is the connection. Knowing is the connection. Using your wisdom is the connection. Using your wisdom. Empowering your wisdom. And how do you do that? By perceiving it. By accepting it. By perceiving it in the right way. No matter how ugly, no matter how difficult, no matter how disappointing things may look, look at it with a different angle. Look at it with a different perception. Look at it with a different vision. And no, it's actually very, very good for me. It's actually the best thing for me. Because the life force only gives you what you need. The life force never gives you what you like. You cannot fool God. You cannot bribe God. Doesn't work with him. He only gives you, like a good father, gives you exactly what you need. So the things that I want is not what my soul wants. My soul wants everything that I need. Maybe I need this difficult time. Maybe I need these challenges because I haven't truly changed myself. We are here to change ourselves. That's the purpose of us being here. We're supposed to reach our maximum potential of goodness, of love, of compassion, of understanding, of patience, of being for somebody else beside myself. You know, if you experience every time that you feel sad, every time you feel disappointed, every time that you're not happy is about you. It's about me. It's about the ego. The ego gets hurt. The ego gets disappointed. The ego doesn't like it. The dark side food. Your neshama loves it. Your neshama, when it sees the situation, it goes, ah, this is exactly what I need. This is the exact test that I need. And how do we see it? How do we change this situation? How do we change these challenges from a negative challenge to an absolute positive? Only by your perception. Only by dictating to the challenge that this is actually very good. You know, you're driving and you get stuck in traffic and you're supposed to make this most important interview of your life. And some old lady in front of you is going 20 miles an hour. Why the life force has put this 90 years old lady who doesn't know how to drive in front of you and is going 15 miles per hour in where she should go 60 miles an hour? And there's no way you cannot pass her, you're stuck. You have two choices, right? Either to become totally aggravated, so, damn it, move it, you old lady, I hate you, I'm late for my, I'm gonna lose my interview, and you're feeding the dark force, and what happens if you totally feed him, you're gonna try to pass him, and the cops is gonna pull you over, or God forbid, you're gonna run into an accident. But what the life force is trying to tell you, maybe you shouldn't make it to this interview. Maybe if you go too fast, you run into a situation that is hazardous to your situation, to your health, to your being. Maybe you need to exercise your patience. Maybe you need to be more understanding. Maybe you need to work on your certainty. Maybe you have to understand that this is good for me. This old lady that is in front of me, God put her in front of me. Love you, God. All right, I'm going to pull back. When you pull back, Now you're not in a reactive, mad, crazy mood now. You're not under the control of the dark horse. Now you're holding on and you're controlling the situation. Now you're proactive. Just for a second. Maybe she's the best thing in my life now. Has it ever happened that you wanted to do something and something happened and you missed that? And you missed that appointment or the flight or whatever. And years later you realize, oh, thank God I didn't go. Thank God it didn't happen. Oh, it was so good for me. How many times it happens? Why we don't see it then and we have to wait 15 years later? Because I was so reactive, I was so under influence of that situation that I was totally blocked by all this clipa that I created around me, and I failed to see the light. I failed to see what was there for me. So what's the secret of overcoming challenges? Push it back. Push it back. Don't react. You hear them, you open, you're expecting acceptance from this amazing job, and you get a letter, sorry, you were wonderful, but, you know, sorry. Maybe God is telling me that there is a better job for me. Maybe there is a better place for me. Maybe if I go to a different route, I will meet my soulmate. Maybe if I go there, my boss would be horrible versus something might happen. And the moment you push it back, then you will see it. You clear this clipa that is around you and you see it. The moment you control it, the moment you push it back, the moment you don't become slave into that situation, the victim of that situation. Every time we lose something, it's always for the better. It's always for the better. Whatever God takes away from you, because He has something better for you. He has something better for you. If you really pay attention, you see that we're so much under the control of our ego. It's just what I want. This is what I want. This will make me happy. This is good for me. But do we see you tomorrow? Do we have a clear perception of what 10 years from now I'm going to be, how I'm going to be? And when I tell myself, you know what, I'm going to trust the life force of God. He's with me. He's with me all the time. I'm going to trust Him. If this doesn't happen, if He's not giving me what I want, then He's saving something more amazing for me. More amazing. Everything, something. Every time that we go for our comfort zone, it's a loss. Every time you seek comfort zone, it's the end. There's no light in it. But every time you let it, bring it on. You know, the Kabbalist, Rabbi Berg used to say, if nobody is complaining, everything is peaceful, must be something wrong. Always had to be something. Always had to be a test. Always has to be a challenge. Always has to be a challenge. The challenges are the vehicle to change, to improve, to enhance ourselves. That's the only way, going through the challenges. You know, we're all going to get there. We all have an origin that we start our life, and we're all going to end up at the end. We will, no matter what. But we can do it voluntarily or involuntarily. Voluntarily is by being proactive, by taking charge, taking responsibility, accepting our position, acknowledging my shortcoming, realizing my talents, learn from the situation, move on. Don't react, don't be upset, don't judge. Just watch what happens. It's like, you know, we're going to go through this ride to the end. It's like a ride on a river, on a boat. And this river has a lot of curves. There's a lot of rocks around it. There's a lot of deep areas that your boat is probably going to sink. But at the end, we're all going to reach. Some of us will get to the end of the road, at end of the ride, broken heart and broken head and broken hands. Because the last time I hit to this rock, I said, damn it, I broke it. But some of us will say, oh, I should be careful with this kind of rock. So next time a bigger rock comes in, you know how to handle it. When you fall into this deep part of the river, you know there are parts that are deep. So next time, instead of being scared and closing my eyes, I'm going to enjoy the ride. Oh, keep my eyes open. Enjoy the ride. Living means living, you know, you hear this cliche, living every second of your life, living every day of your life. What does that mean? What does that mean, every second of your life? I want to live every, you should live every moment of your life. I mean, we all have a goal, right? Some of us may think, well, I'm going to be happy when I get married. I'm going to be happy when I have my children. I'm going to be happy when I graduate. I'm going to be happy when I have this. We have a goal. And until we reach that goal, we're not happy. If you're not happy now, you're not going to be even happy when you reach your goal. It never works that way. No, I'm happy with the process. I am happy with the process. I'm going to enjoy the process. Because the whole thing is process, guys. At the end of the movie finishes. Some people think, you know, I'm so lonely, I need to find a girlfriend, a boyfriend, I need to get married so I'll be happy. Then you get married and you see you're still not happy. Or maybe I have a child and I'll be happy, and you get one child and you're still not happy. And then the second child, and you have five children and you're miserable.
Poor children.
And that was wrong.
You know, because I always look for something else to give me the contentment, the happiness. No. No, you make the happiness with your perception, with your thought, with your wisdom. I'm going to enjoy every minute of my life. That means I'm going to enjoy every challenge of my life. I'm going to look at my challenges in a different way, with a different angle, with a different perception, knowing and trusting and having certainty that this is absolutely the best thing for me. God loves you guys so much. Loves you guys so much. And he only gives you what is the best for you. The best for you. You know, I always give this example in the Farsi class. Like a mother who has this child who has a fever. Has a fever, has a, the baby has a sore throat, and infection, and she's crying, and the baby cannot swallow anything, and high fever and all that. What the baby wants? She wants an ice cream, you know, give me an ice cream so I feel better. Make me calm. But the doctors prescribed this awful tasting liquor that is antibiotic and it tastes like hell, but it's really going to help the child. So the mom, with this purity of her heart, has to push down that medicine, the throat of the little child, and the little child is screaming, what are you doing to me? Don't you see I'm feeling awful? I can't even taste anything, and you're giving me this crap? Right? That's how we react. Not knowing that this crap is the best thing for me. It's going to heal me. Otherwise, I'll die. Otherwise, I die. Only by changing your perception towards life, only seeing that everybody who's in your movie are the best people in your movie, and the people who give you more hard time in your life, they are the true angels of your life. Whoever gives you a hard time in your life is the best medicine for you, best people in your life. They're the angels. The guy who tells you the things you're vulnerable with, you know, if you're vulnerable towards something and this guy comes and always gives it to you, that means, you know, I got to change that thing in me. God is giving me a hint to change that. to look at it differently. You know, when the Torah says, you know, there is this, I'm going to say this and we can finish it up. So we have this giant Kabbalist, his name is Rabbi Akiva. This is the time of, during the time of Jesus. So this emperor from the Romans gets Rabbi Akiva and tells him, I want you to tell me what it is your Torah is all about. One sentence, you give me what your Torah is all about. And he says, love thy neighbor as yourself. The rest is commentary. Love your neighbor as yourself. What does it mean? Love thy neighbor as yourself. First of all, you have to love yourself in order to love somebody else. If you don't love yourself, how could you love somebody else? Loving yourself means loving everything about you. All the shortcoming and all the talent, everything, your whole package. The whole package. When you're totally in love with yourself, now the second phase comes, which says, thy neighbor. That neighbor, that doesn't mean only the good-looking neighbor, only the nice neighbor, only the Jewish neighbor. No. That neighbor could be a Russian, could be a German, could be an ISIS, could be whatever. And what does it mean? When you love yourself, that means when you know that everything that is around you is for your own good, and you have that love, then you don't react to the race, to sex, to anything else. You don't judge anybody. You don't judge anybody. And you just understand that they are part of your movie. They are part of your movie. And if I still don't love everybody around me, don't see them as the best thing in me, in my life, I'm not seeing the life force in people. See the light in everybody's around you. Everybody's around you is a messenger sent by the life force to help you out, to help you change, to help you improve, to help you reach your potential. And understand your potential, guys. You guys are Age of Aquarius. You guys are different. You guys are much smarter than my age, much brighter. Much, much, much wiser, much more capable. Your potentials are beyond my understanding. Every one of you guys has a special, special, special talent, special gift. The fact that you're born at this time, that means your soul has so much potential. And when you have a talent in something, use that talent as a globe that makes a global effect. Not just for myself alone. Don't make it a slave to your ego. Your talent should help other people. Should really go out of you. And when you make that, when you see the life like that, you don't think of yourself, then you're totally in control. You're proactive. Every time you react, you're into yourself. Have you noticed? Every time you react, you're into yourself. Oh, I'm afraid. I'm into myself. Oh, I don't have to, I don't believe in myself. Oh, I don't know. It's all about I. It's all about the ego. Your neshama loves everything. Loves everything that is around you. So enjoy the process. Enjoy every minute of the process. You know, if they put a question to you, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, which one is most important?
Today.
Today. Why?
Because it affects tomorrow.
Today erases or fixes yesterday. Everything is in today. Everything is today. Today is everything. Enjoy today. Live today. Appreciate what you have today. Look at it with a different angle. Look at it with a different perception. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
By the way, I'm not here next week, so no class next Tuesday, I apologize. And the week after, we're going to have a class again.